You know, I appreciated that opening music, Don't Start, Stop Believing, because when I was thinking about this, I was kind of like the little train that can. It's like, you can do this, you know. But the song's good because where I'm going to kind of take the direction of the assignment that I was given was advance yourself. And so kind of my remarks and putting them together is they're all internal. They're for things for you to think about inside and most of all, believe in yourself. I put this out there when they ask us for our bio. If you notice, I don't have any PhD. I don't have any big degrees. I went to a technical school. Back when I went to school to go into graphic arts and design and paste up and layout was a technical field. And I went to trade tech up in Provo, Utah. And that's where my background, my education was. But it's the learning process that throughout the years have continued to learn and continue to evolve has helped me with my business and my passion to be able to grow it into something that I have a lot of fun with. Now, sometimes people think that when you're the leader of a company in a key position or you own a business that you've made it to the top of a mountain and you've driven the flag of success in the ground and it's like you're there. When the reality is you're clinging to the cliff on the side of the mountain, you're butt naked, it's cold, and you're hanging on for dear life. But the whole question that comes in now is what type of person are you? You're hanging there. Are you a mountaineer? Are you figuring out a way up off the cliff and to continue this journey, to keep going and to keep working through and advance your career and advance where you want to go with your life? Because that's what it comes down to. We all hit obstacles. We all have difficult things that we have to go through, but it's about overcoming those and being real with what's going on in life so that you can achieve those goals and those objectives. I've broken this down into three sections. And what I've tried to do with this presentation is pull out things that I've seen that have been the greatest stumbling blocks to people in setting their path with their career and where they want to go with it. So the first one in covering it is understand yourself. Peter F. Drucker said this about people who are wanting to get ahead in their career. He says, it's up to you to carve out your place in the work world and know when to change course. And it's up to you to keep yourself engaged and productive during a work life that may span some 50 years. To do all these things well, you need to cultivate a deep understanding of yourself. What are your most valuable strengths and your most dangerous weaknesses? Equally important, how do you learn? And I'm talking about there, how do you mentally learn? And how well do you work with others? What are your most deeply held values? And what type of work environment can you make the greatest contribution? I think that's important. What type of work environment can you make the greatest contribution? The implication is clear, and I'm still quoting here, only when you operate from a combination of your strengths and your self-knowledge can you achieve true, lasting excellence. And I so believe that. You know, years ago when I was starting out my career and I was getting going, I was in sales. And I remember the vice president of sales was sitting down with me and I was doing quite well. And he said, Jeff, what do you want to do with your future? Where do you want to go? What do you want to do? And I remember I leaned back and I said, you know, I think I want to go into management. And he looked at me and he chuckled and he's smiling like some of you that know me, you know, in this situation. He says, Jeff, you're an incredible salesman, but a manager you are not. And at the time it was kind of like deflating. It's like, well, what do you mean? I there's no future in life. I can't go into management. And he was letting me know that my temperament and my characteristics were such that you're not going to be a great manager. You're great at other things, but it's not managing. And I had to sit back and decide, okay, now I could have taken one of two courses. One, I could have said, you know, how insensitive. He's just a mighty Heidi jerk saying something like that. Or he doesn't really know me. How can he tell me about what I can do and what I can't do? But what I did is I stepped back and thought, why would he say that? And I had to think a little bit about my personality, my character traits, what were my strengths, what were my weaknesses, and realize that there's aspects about being a manager that someone who was a vice president of a company and in management saw in me that saw, I'm going to struggle in this area. So that helped me as I began my career to realize there's some things there. Ask yourself some of these questions and jot them down. Are you a team player or do you work best on your own? Me, I work best on my own, for good or for bad. Do you want to be the one in charge and bear the weight of making the difficult decisions? Or do you need to gather a team around you to support you in your decision and share in the successes or failures? And are you proficient at staying on task? Now, in asking these questions, and this is the real point that I'm going to get to, is are you going to be honest with yourself? Honesty with yourself is a big deal. Don't self-justify, okay? Don't go in and say, well, I'm this or that, or I was working on this project, and give a reason or an excuse. One of my friends, Dean Peterson, the president of Harmon's, he says, excuse, he's got a sign up on his wall. He says, excuses are just a definition of poor planning. And so when you do this, and as you think about your career and what you're doing, get out of the self-justifying mode and get down to what's real. If somebody makes a comment or something about your performance or improved performance, understand yourself and where you're at and understand where you need to be and who you are so that you can understand your strengths and get past the self-justification. I love this quote here. It's out of a book by Elliot Aronson, and he says this: self-justification is not the same thing as lying or making excuses. It's more powerful and dangerous than an explicit lie. It allows people to convince themselves that what they did was the best thing that they could have done. In fact, come to think about it, it was the right thing all along. Self-justification is a portrayal of the brain, I think that's important. It's a portrayal of the brain that despite its stated goals or desires, is not interested in the truth. The brain's not interested in the truth, but rather in self-preservation. It's not interested in the truth, but in self-preservation. And for some reason, we've got it in our head that if we are wrong or we make a mistake, that we're possibly dumb or stupid or incompetent, which isn't the case. We're just human. We all make mistakes, but being able to work through those and get past that self-justification will matter so much because, and I'm quoting here still, he said, mindless justification, like quicksand, can draw us deeper into disaster. And this is the key point of the quote. It blocks our ability to even see our errors, let alone correct them. It distorts reality, keeping us from getting all the information we need to assess issues clearly. So work on getting past the justification and blaming it on other people. If there's a problem, own it. Move forward. Even if it isn't yours, own it. Move forward. I like this famous quote by Covey, Stephen R. Covey. He says, "We see the world not as it is, but as we are." So the things that we perceive and that we understand, it's only through our own experiences. We see the world as not as it is, but as we are. So, with that being said, and we've talked about self-justification, let's take a couple minutes and write down or think about it here. What are your greatest weaknesses? And what are a couple of your greatest strengths? Okay, let's move on a little bit. So understand yourself. Work through the self-justification and be honest in saying, what are your strengths and what are your weaknesses? I'll put this out there. I struggle with being a team player. I want to just kind of take things and run with them. I'm a terrible speller. I can write an email, but it takes me 3 hours. And so I have some difficulties. And being able to understand those has enabled me to say, it's okay. So I'm able to have people around me that I can count on, that I work with, to help me improve on my weaknesses, to make up for them. And that's okay. The next thing I'm going through is this next section, is what do you want to have happen? And it's important that you understand, I didn't say what do you want to do, but what do you want to have happen? So we're looking at the end result, but knowing that it may be variable, okay? Sometimes people want to put a set of checklists together and say, oh, I'm going to go back to school, and I'm going to do this, 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 and this, or I need to have this position, and you kind of have this set of checklists, and then I've talked with people that get done with their master's degree and their stuff, and it's like, well, it just didn't work out the way I wanted it to be. I had this plan, but they had a set of checklists, not looking at the end result and say, what do I want to have happen, and then organizing a plan that's dynamic and saying, my end result's going to be this. They put together a set of to-dos. This is not a to-do list. This is what you want to have happen list. So let's try something a little bit. Who here have been involved in athletics? Anyone? When you're with the coach and he asks you to visualize something, why is he asking you to visualize it?
To help you accomplish what you said not to do.
Right, to help you accomplish it. You're able to build a mental model of what's going to happen. So when the situation takes place, you know, oh, I've already worked this out in my mind. I'm going to roll left. I'm going to block this way. I'm going to do this. So he's helping you visualize out situations that may happen or they'll come about. So what I want you to do is visualize here for a minute. We're going to sit back and relax and visualize. Now, I notice here Scott Levitt, he's already visualizing. I haven't even told him the topic yet. It's like, were you in Hawaii, man? He was just kind of relaxing. His head was there. He was going to town visualizing. What I want you to visualize is, where do you want to be 3 years from now? And not just be like in your job position, but what do you want your relationships to be like? How do you want to feel inside? And where do you want your career to be? But kind of take a minute, visualize it, and write that down. And remember this. What are your greatest strengths and your greatest weaknesses? And how do they apply? Okay, as you've kind of getting this visualizing a little bit, and you're saying, this is where I want to be. And what do I want to have happen? And we question the term, what do I want to happen, or what do I want to have happen? And I looked at it and I said, I like the word have. That means I want to have something. That means I'm taking ownership to what's going to happen. This is mine. I'm taking ownership what's going to happen here. So that's what we put in. What do we want to have happen? Now, I visualized when I started my business and I moved to Cedar City and I came down here and we were kind of just getting going. It was growing, and I realized that within the Cedar market, it wasn't going to be big enough to encapsulate my vision of where I wanted to go and what I wanted to do. So I started working out different plans to grow the business, different things. What could I do to help the business grow? And a gentleman contacted me up in Richfield about buying his store, his sign company out. And I had another contact in Delta that talked to me about buying his out. So I had these contacts with these other sign companies. And so I sat down, and I'm all about plans and envisioning. And I stole this. This is our company book. And everything we do, there's always a plan. There's always a vision. It's booked. It's tabbed. It's written out. I always, every year, I kind of, to some degree, rewrite our business plan. But this has our next 3 to 5 year plan written out, documented, what we're going to do, what we want to have happen. And I have done this with the idea that, you know what, I'm going to pick up these micro branch sign companies around the area, have them continue to offer basic signs, banners, and things like that. And then when it comes to the big stuff, my Cedar location will act as a distribution point where we can make the big stuff and supply all the small sign companies, and I would grow the company to cover the midsection of Utah down through southern Utah with all these satellite offices. And I'd ran the numbers, I did my forecast, my pro formas, and I was excited about this plan. I thought, oh, it's good, it came to mind, I was able to put it together. And at the time, I was taking a course through the SUU Small Business Development Center, which I give Joni's a part of and take advantage of the resources there. I was taking a class through there. And Greg Powell was the instructor. And I had to do a little presentation. And I presented this new business idea on how I wanted to do it. And after I got done presenting it, Greg challenged me with this. He says, okay, you've got your business plan. But now go back and look at it dollar for dollar. And look at every product that you have and add in the amount of time it takes you to sell it and the amount of time it takes you to bill it and collect it and everything in the process. And add that in. I know you've got your margins and everything, but add the total cost in and say, what will this new venture do to your overall profitability? And he says, find out what is your most profit and will it affect your most profitable products? So I did this. I went back and I was like a little frustrated because I thought everybody was going to like cheer me on. Yeah, this is a good idea you've got. And I went back and started tearing it apart. And as I got into it and dove deeper into it, I realized that one of the smaller sections of my business that I was developing was actually my most profitable part of the business. I was doing work for Smith's Food and Drug, and I was cutting out foam letters. And as I thought about it, I thought, you know, that's what I went to school in, was design and layout, and I really love this side of the business. You know, it's not going to be a quick switch to all at once, like, boom, have a bigger area. But as I sat and worked the plan, it's like, you know, though, I can do this retail decor, and I'm doing it for grocery store for Smith's, but there's grocery stores all over. So I'm not going to be limited to just Utah. So I changed the direction. I dropped this whole other business plan. Though it was a good idea and it was great, it wasn't the best. And I sat down and rethought it and thought, okay, I put a plan together that says when it comes to grocery store decor and design, we're going to be the best in the state of Utah. And, well, there really wasn't any decor companies in the state of Utah. So we achieved that goal really quick. But then we set the next goal to say we want to be the best decor company in the Intermountain area. From Montana to Arizona, we laid it out. We had goals, and we achieved that. We achieved that with a number of, we want to be doing 90% of the independent grocers in the Intermountain area. That's how we'll know we'll be have achieved that. And then we took it step by step and laid out a plan. I remember when I first was going into Texas, people were like, you're crazy. What are we going into Texas for? We got enough business here. Why do we need to do that? This is uncomfortable. We grew from Texas, we went over to Louisiana, then we went up to the Midwest, and now we do work. We've got jobs up in Maine, Pennsylvania, Florida, Georgia, and the majority of our work is actually outside the area that we're shipping to. But it all went back to somebody telling me my plan maybe wasn't right. But I had to work it through and really, really think it through. But I came up with a better plan that allowed us to grow nationally. Now, one thing that we do within our company that's great with what you've got in your hand, and my wife's really good at it, is we keep what we call a decision journal. And mine's private. I don't let people read it. I pull it out and I think about it. But what you do is you need to do it in your own handwriting. And if it's even this book, do it, because it would be great to tie it in. But write out a decision that you're making with your company or your life or whatever, and why you're making that decision, and what are the expected results. Because it allows you, as time goes on with that plan, to remember this was the desired result. And you can't go back and self-justify and say, oh, this was the outcome we were meaning to get in the first place. But it allows you to analyze the situation in such a way to say, are we able to decide what we want to have happen? Is that happening? Because you create that baseline in there for you to evaluate your performance, the performance of the idea, and where you want to go with it, how you want to grow. But that decision journal, when you go back and it's like, how did we get here? You can go back and read in your own handwriting, this is why I did what I did. And that oftentimes grounds you, especially when everybody tells you the choices you've made are wrong. But it's like, you know, I'm going to stay on course. I've done my research. I've done my planning. This is a good way to go. And the other thing that we do in our company is we fire bullets, then cannonballs. There's a book by Jim Collins called Great by Choice. I love Jim Collins' stuff. In this book, he talks about firing bullets first and then firing cannonballs. So when you're making decisions, oftentimes an idea comes to mind. And it's like, oh, we want to expand here or do this. So you take the cannon and you dump a ton of gunpowder in it. You pack it with the big lead ball and you fire it and it's expensive and you miss. Well, there's a lot of money that just went out in that gunpowder and that lead. So what we've been working on, and with us and our business, we work in retail design. Well, what's going on with the retail market and Amazon and buying online? What's happening with all of these malls and shopping places across the country? They're kind of shrinking up. They're changing. They're calling it the retail apocalypse. Luckily, it hasn't hit food yet. But we've been knowing about this and been planning on it for several years. So we've been firing bullets. That the best way to describe what a bullet is a bullet is low cost, a bullet is low risk, and a bullet is a low distraction, okay? Now, all of these are variables. So like Intermountain Healthcare, they can afford a much bigger, expensive bullet than what Metalcraft could. And so it depends on the size of your organization. And a bullet that it's low distraction means it's low distraction for the company. It may distract some people in your organization's lives completely because you've got to get them working on it. But you're able to refine, and as you sit and shoot, you're able to go to a larger caliber and a larger caliber. Now, right now, we're making a big pivot within our company. But we already know our customers. We know who we want to sell to, and we found out who we do not want to sell to. And we're able to make this adjustment, and we're launching a cannonball, in fact, this next week or so, and putting a lot of money into it and moving things out and making some adjustments to adjust our market and kind of pivot the company to be able to embrace the new growth and the new things within our area. So fire bullets, then cannonballs. And if you can read this book, Great by Choice, it's an excellent book. It's all based off of, and it's on your sheet. I've got it referenced there. But it's all based off using empirical data. So we're not using our guts to make decisions, but we're using empirical data. So as I've expanded and grown, I measure everything. How much is each division doing? What's each warehouse doing? How's each salesperson doing in each one of these areas? So I use that empirical data, and I analyze that, and I look at it and say, what is this telling me? Or what's the real truth here? Not what do I want it to be, or not is it working somebody else's agenda, but just what's the truth about this? And I look to that data to give me the information that I need. Because you'll find, and we'll go into it a little bit here, that what you think most often is wrong. But if you use empirical data, you're able to have something to base your decisions off of. And that kind of takes us into this next section. So we've got understanding yourself. So if you can kind of envision it, understand where you want to go, what you want to have happen. Look at your career, your life, your weaknesses, your strengths. And then right here, intention plus learning equals advancement. But to be able to make that move, you have to base it on what's real in life and on this empirical data that you're gathered. And you need to learn to force yourself to think. I know this sounds funny. We all think. I joke with myself all the time that my brain is the laziest organ in my entire body. It's the only one that does, it's the only organ I have that does as much as it can not to be used and to become as useless as possible. In fact, I spend more time thinking about having to get out of having to think than it would have actually taken me to complete the thought. You know, and our brains have that ability to kind of just turn off. I mean, how many people have driven to Salt Lake and it's like, did we pass Fillmore? Like, and I'm looking down, I have to keep the GPS going. It's like, right? My brain is completely shut off. It said, I don't need to remember any of this stuff. I've already seen that sagebrush so many times. I've already seen that mountain. I know where I'm off. And our brains turn off. And we're not thinking. It's just in an idle mode. And there's a process. And it's, I'm going to kind of jump ahead here. It's written by Daniel Kahneman. It's a book called Thinking Fast and Slow. And breaks down your thinking into type one, or system one thinking, and system two thinking. System one thinking operates automatically and quickly with little or no effort and no sense of voluntary control, okay? So, 2 + 2 = 4. Now, did you have to think about that? No, it was just automatic. There was no control. The number 4 popped into your head. It was just there. And oftentimes when we have difficult situations in life and things that we're dealing with, your brain's going to pull that idea that you've already experienced or that you've already done and say, oh, this is the answer. Oh, yep, I've done this before. This is the answer. System two thinking, effortful mental activities that demand high-level thinking, including complex computations. So you're going to have to stop oftentimes and engage the brain. And it's going to fight you. It's going to say, I'm tired. It's just after lunch. I want to take a nap. Or you're going to say, oh, before I can do this, I got to go get me a Red Bull or something. Because, you know, your brain's going to fight you on it. Like I say, for me, it's the laziest organ in my body. It's going to justify, oh, I can figure this out tomorrow. But stop the justification. Stop putting it off. What do I want to have happen? And actually begin to think and to dive in and work through the problems. Analyze the data. Think through what you want to have happen. With my business, I've had a look at it and think it through and say, how big do I want to be? Or how small? What do I want it to feel like? What do I want to feel like? So as we were talking about things there, about when you're envisioning it, what do you want to do and what do you want it to feel and the decisions and what's the implication? When we make a decision, I always break it down into a grid pattern and put multiple things as far as the sacrifices that it's going to take. And I always put down the emotional sacrifice along with the financial and everything else. But what's the emotional sacrifice going to be? And am I willing to make it? Now, for me, my business could be bigger. I could have got outside investors. I could have done a lot more. But it's like I tell a lot of my people, be careful, because this place, it will suck you for everything you can give and more. So make sure you keep a balance. Don't let it take too much. For me, my love of family and doing things with my wife is more important than my business. And so I made sure that I'm putting that in. And I grew my business at a rate that I could have what was most important and develop it. So as you're looking at your career, don't sacrifice everything that's important to you, but understand what you really want to have happen, be honest, and then take the information that you're learning here and sit down and think about it. Now, all of us are different learners. Some of us learn by writing. Some of us learn by talking. I'm one that has to talk before the connections. But if you teach it, take the stuff that you've got, and write it out and take it and teach it to someone else. And for each one of these classes, do that, and that will help you remember the stuff and will make these classes meaningful. And it will change the way you go about it. You don't want to just say, oh, I'm going to my course, and then walk away and not really remember anything. So take advantage of these courses and use them, but make them available so that you can change the way you think. I mean, literally change the way you think, because your brain's going to want to go back to the old way. But take the new information and change the way you're thinking and the way you're working with it. So to give you a quick example, and many of you may have seen this, which one has the larger middle line, the top one or the bottom one? Both the same, but what did your brain tell you when you first looked at it? The top one was shorter. And that's the way we want to do so many things, is we want to jump in and say, oh, it's the top one, and we move on. When you're right, they're both the same. And so that's that part of the brain that just wants to jump in. Now, let me go to the right thing. So Ray Dalio, he's written a book called Principles. I love the book. It's fantastic. And he talks about, and I'm going to go through this, and don't try to write it all down at once. He says, these are the things you need to have to succeed. One, have clear goals. Two, identify and don't tolerate problems that stand in the way of achieving those goals. Three, accurately diagnose problems to get to the root cause, okay? Design plans that will get you around them and do what's necessary to push these designs through to results. So if we look at it, we may have a plan that's taking us this way, right? And then we come along and we've got a problem. You have to stop self-justifying, be real, understand what that problem is, and identify there's a problem here. Then accurately diagnose it. So that's just not saying, oh, there's a problem, because oftentimes we see the symptoms of a problem out here, but you've got to diagnose to the root. What's the root problem here? Is it that I just don't like my desk at work? Or there's a coworker that I can't work with? Or this job, I can't learn it? Or various different things. But get to the root of what the problem is in this and diagnose it. And then from diagnosing it, design a plan. Design the plan to get around it. And then, like he says, do what's necessary to put this design into work so you're getting the results you need. And you're back on track again. Because you're doing this, guys. You know, the spreadsheet may say you're doing this, but there's a whole lot of this spinning that goes along as you go through it. So remember to understand the problem, diagnose it, design a solution, and then get to it and do it. And keep moving. Don't let it bog you down. But if you think, engage the brain, you can come up with fantastic, fantastic solutions. I'm just going to jump down here and wrap up. So, the goal is here to understand yourself. Understand what you want to have happen based off of who you are and what you're, where you're going. And then take that and be intentional with knowing yourself, being intentional with your aspirations, be intentional with your goals, and that, I promise you, will lead you to having an intentional life. You're in control at this point. You don't, you know, I have this joke, and it goes back years ago with one of my coworkers. You guys don't have to do anything. The only thing that any of us have to do in life is die. But other than that, it's all up to us. I had somebody say, well, no, I have to breathe. It's like, no, you can stop breathing. It's just the end result is you'll die. But that's the one thing we have to do. So have intention in your life. And be. I kind of issue this as a closing challenge. Take ownership of it. Figure out where you want to be. Envision it and take advantage of these classes. And I'll end with one of my favorite quotes. It's incredibly easy to get caught up in an activity trap. In the busyness of life, to work harder and harder at climbing the ladder of success, only to discover that it's leaning against the wrong wall. Make sure your ladder is leaning up against the right wall. Thank you.